Quentin Tarantino's two-volume revenge saga, it's the men who do the talking while the women fight to the death. Events are often violent and bloody, but what do you expect when the protagonist is a deadly assassin and her old team are the targets? Uma Thurman's bride is left for dead at a wedding rehearsal in Texas, but the deadly Viper assassination squad should really have made sure to finish her off when they had the chance. There are 10 chapters split across the two films, told in non-chronological order, and the first target we actually see is the bride's second. Vernita Green is enjoying retirement in suburban America and is now married with a young daughter, but that doesn't earn her any sympathy from the bride. The two women battle each other and between them wreck most of the furniture, and it's a fairly even contest before Vernita's little girl shows up and the assassins put the fighting on hold.
Bill always said you were one of the best ladies he ever saw with an edge weapon.
Fuck you, bitch. I know he didn't qualify that shit. So you can just kiss my motherfucking ass, Black Mamba. Black Mamba. I should have been motherfucking Black Mamba.
Weapon of choice? If you want to stick with your butcher knife, that's fine with me.
Very funny, bitch. Very funny!
With one victim dead, we're shown puzzled Texas cops investigate the chapel aftermath and the supposedly dead bride who turns out not to be. Elle Driver is the most psycho assassin on the team and really hates the bride, so she's not best pleased when the title Bill decides it's not chivalrous to kill a woman in a coma. Skip forward 4 years and the bride wakes up with a metal plate in her skull and a vendetta against the hit squad who murdered the groom. Most men, and women for that matter, are treated as expendable. Often we get fancy camera angles and tinted colour palettes to add variety to the ongoing violence. A handful of characters actually put up a worthy fight, but most never last more than 10 seconds. The bride is a one-woman army, and while the individual female antagonist might just scrape legendary status at a push, the ensemble trio of villainesses are worthy of a top 15 ranking place. While the first volume did have roughly 50% action, there's barely 5% in the second half. By now the bride has 3 targets remaining, Buddy's a washed out hitman living in a trailer, and Billy's now a family man fond of lengthy conversations. Once more it's left to the females to deliver the excitement. If this summary seems brief, it's because there's not much to talk about despite the movie being over 2 hours long. Even a minor character, an Asian assassin who the bride talks down by revealing she's pregnant, gets more action than Bill, who's eventually taken down by a death touch. Yep, the final boss fight never materialises. This movie tends to subvert expectations and has a lot of skilled assassins achieve victory over superior opponents by cheating. The bride shows up to confront Bud, all decked out in ninja garb, only to get shot and buried alive in the desert. So it's a good thing she listened to a brutal sensei and can bust her way out of a wooden box. After literally rising from the grave, it's time to confront the final woman on the hit list. The treacherous elf finishes off Bud, who she could easily kill in a fair fight by planting a snake in a bag of money. There's a wonderfully chilling scene where the assassin reads out the prophecies of the venom coursing through Bud's veins. Then the bride returns and the real fight begins. Elle now has the sword in advantage, but the bride is a tough woman to take down. And like most locations where female assassins have it out in these films, the trailer ends up destroyed. The bride gets hold of Bud's old sword and it's revealed how Elle lost her eye. Telling a vengeful woman you murdered a former mentor is probably not the smartest play.
Yeah.
anti-heroine leaves the blind woman alone with a pet snake, and Elle's final fate is left to the viewer's imagination. Not one of Tarantino's films, even though it pretends to be. Weird characters populate this man caught in the middle of a gang war tale, all conveniently introduced with title cards just so we know who they are. Cowboys and Indians are a prominent theme, and two bosses, the chief and the rancher, battle over a tribal warrior mask stolen by a gang of Elvis impersonators. Yes, this movie is just as crazy as it sounds. The man in the middle is John Smith, played by Christian Slater, and there are also appearances by Jeff Fahey as the double revolver-toting cowboy, Gary Oldman as the ringleader Elvis, and Megan Park as the seemingly innocent girl next door, but naturally she's not who she seems. Plenty of people die before the final showdown is done, with minor characters such as henchmen and two corrupt sheriffs biting the dust before the more important players. The deadliest assassin in town is the unnamed blonde who recites Edgar Allan Poe quotes before blowing her victims away.
Now where is the mask?
I don't have it.
Wrong answer.
This woman, dressed all in black and the subject of frequent sexy rear shots, is the coolest character and skilled in both acrobatics and firearms. This allows her to emerge unscathed from her bloody encounters, escape double crosses and surprise attacks, and ride off into the sunset with a prostitute accomplice and a suitcase full of money. Everyone else ends up on the losing side except for John Smith, who played the others from the start. The blonde standout moment, and there are plenty to choose from, is besting the Indian who foolishly brings a tomahawk to a gunfight. In a movie littered with corpses, this female assassin has the highest kill count, so John Smith wisely lets the blonde and a leather-clad lover keep their share. As the final boss of Volume 1, O-Ren Ishii gets a badass introduction, well actually three of them. First up's an animated backstory that shows O-Ren's own revenge tale against the Yakuza boss who murdered her parents, a rise as an assassin, and finally the wedding attack that made her the bride's first target. The 7-minute cartoon is just as violent as any live action segment, but those viewers eager for real action won't have to wait long. That ends any dissent and establishes the villainess as a truly ruthless woman. With the bride now in Tokyo, after a flight where katanas are apparently allowed in the main cabin, there's a montage of her wearing a yellow jumpsuit on a motorcycle, while O-Ren rides in a limousine flanked by her own biker enforcers. The bride, by means of a voice-over narration, introduces O-Ren's key lieutenants. These include a domino mass leader of a crazy 88 gang, a beautiful but timid assistant Sophie Fatale, and the far more deadly and sadistic Gogo. For the third introduction, okay, we get O-Ren's a badass by now, the villainess enters a club with her minions close behind as epic music plays in the background. The final chapter of Volume 1 is essentially a half-hour long action sequence where the bride takes on all comers. Like any crime boss, O-Ren has disposable mooks to throw at the anti-heroine. After the bride chops off Sophie's arm just to show how serious she is, one poor guy is sent in alone and routinely dispatched as the villainess watches from the balcony. Then come a few more guys for the bride to deal with, none of them any good, and there's also a female in the moot ranks, but she doesn't last much longer. And it's not until Gogo steps down to the lower floor that the bride has any real competition.
Oh.
As the only henchwoman to receive an introductory flashback, it's obvious the ball and chain wielding psycho would prove much more difficult to defeat.
It is.
You didn't think it was going to be that easy, did you?
You know, for a second there? Yeah, I kind of did.
After that humorous interlude, it's then the bride against a whole army of thugs. Most of the carnage is shot in black and white, but none of the violence is toned down. Plenty of people lose arms and legs fighting the bride, but don't manage to land a single blow against a well-trained adversary. Even the leader lasts less than a minute, not from the upper balcony after the bride slices off his leg. O-Ren walks away mid-fight, almost as if her goons are intended to tire the bride out rather than actually kill her. After all the build-up, don't expect a great final confrontation. It's stylish enough, with the two swordswomen circling about each other in the snow as the tempo raises, but very few blows are traded in the end.
Silly Caucasian girl likes to play with samurai swords. You may not be able to fight like a samurai, but you can at least die like a samurai.
When O-Ren has done gloating, the bride rises to fight on, and after a few more sword slashes, it's O-Ren's turn to get cut. As O-Ren collapses in the snow, the prevailing thought as a first-time viewer was, is that it? And I suspect many other Villainess fans will feel the same way.